So I hope you have had a good time in this academy so far. This is the fourth module, Substrate. My name is Kian. I'm a core developer at Parity. I've had the pleasure to be in all PBAs so far. It's always very fun. Usually I stay longer. This time I'm not staying too long, leaving next week, but it's good to be here, and I hope... already lost it. Okay. I hope we have a good time together and, you know, learn a lot. What else? I've done many things in the past, let's say, in Parity and Polkadot, but at the moment I'm leading the team in charge of developing Frame. Frame will be taught to you next week by my former team lead and dear friend Sean, so stay tuned for that as well. This week will be the Substrate, or this module would be Substrate. So let's get right into it. A few more notes about this module and lectures and lecture. So all the lectures are hopefully very ground up and low level, as in we try to cover less topics but deeply and learn them well. The things that you learn in this module they're practical, but you should be aware that most of you would end up actually developing a blockchain or a parachain using Frame. So there is this component that Substrate is more like the underlying machine, and we're trying to learn that machine. You will, even the assignment that you have for this week, it's very good for your learning practices. It's called a frameless runtime. It's a frameless blockchain. It's amazing for learning, but I think very few people would actually write their parachain in that way. So keep that in mind, as in it's practical, but it's also a lot about learning things at a deep level. As mentioned, we're going to avoid going into Frame as much as possible. In little corners, it might be unavoidable, but that will be the agenda. Ask questions and interrupt me as much as you want. It will be my responsibility to, if there's too many questions, then postpone them to the end of the question. But your job is to ask as many questions as you want, so don't hold anything back. Also, the way I try and teach these things, I'm usually narrative-based, so maybe my lectures are, let's say, instead of going through a lot of facts in a sequence, I try to form a narrative, so keep that in mind. I think it would also help you follow along with me. And finally, as Alex also, I think, have been telling you in the announcement chat and so on, please don't spare your feedback and share it with us. It will help me and everyone else improve. Okay, so what is Substrate? The simplest definition, Substrate is a framework for building blockchains. It's like a factory whose job is to spit out new blockchains. And why do we care about such a tool to exist? It goes back to a bet on the future, or an ideology that exists in this ecosystem, that is, we want a future that is multi-chain. As in, we want to have different blockchains for different purposes and applications that are specialized in different things. So the reasoning starts with accepting that the future is multi-chain, or we bet that it is. And then if we accept this, we are faced with the fact that building a blockchain is difficult, and then upgrading it is even harder. So it's a very... If we don't have this framework, it's going to be very difficult. We want a multi-chain future. At the same time, it's hard to build them, so it's kind of tricky. And this is why it's important that we have a framework for this, and this is why Substrate exists. So I'll come back to this image and the text on it at the end of the slide again. This is taken from a talk from 2018 from Gav. It's a pretty good talk. I have it in the speaker notes. But I like the image and the text. It's like a Substrate and all the things that it enables, it's a bet against chain maximalism. And chain maximalism is the opposite of a multi-chain future. It's the assumption that there's going to be one blockchain to rule them all, or we're going to optimize one blockchain to be the best of best. All right. 1 second, sorry. Okay, some far further philosophical things about Substrate and the way and how it approaches this situation. So this is the non-Substrate way of thinking. As I said, the premise is that building blockchains is hard. It's also very hard to upgrade them. And the non-substrate way of thinking about this is that, okay, it's a difficult task. We're going to put all of our effort into getting it right the first time. So we're going to bring in the best engineers, think 5, 10, 20 years in advance and make sure we get all the right parameters and the right software designs and everything. So we build one blockchain and it's going to be perfect forever. And does this work? No. And we have seen that it actually hasn't worked so far as well. There's a couple of examples. With Bitcoin, we've seen, for example, that the network and its block size have been like the topic of debate for a long time. This is one example of like the initial designers of a blockchain, Bitcoin and Satoshi or whoever came up with it, putting just a block size number there, a little bit arbitrarily, and without knowing actually how famous this blockchain is going to get. And then years down the road, it becoming an issue and it becomes a bottleneck, and then there's no easy way to upgrade it, so on and so forth. I think Ethereum and L2s are also like an interesting thought bubble here, like something to think about. As in why all these L2s have to exist, it's mainly because Ethereum has been kind of slow, similar to Bitcoin in some sense, to like meet the demands of the day in terms of like throughput or like flexibility and so on. And then L2s came because Ethereum wasn't ready enough, let's say, to scale Ethereum before Ethereum is ready to scale itself. Side note, I think there's a lot of interesting development in the L2 space. I have, again, in my speaker notes, some references and so on. Very cool stuff happening here. But I think it's important to acknowledge that they are here because Ethereum itself was slow to upgrade. I learned this piece of history actually rather recently. Ethereum for years was going in the direction or saying that we're going to deliver something that's called execution sharding, as in we're going to shard Ethereum at the execution layer, so it's going to be like multiple shards and so on. And now with the L2-centric narrative, it's actually completely different. Ethereum is going to remain this like settlement layer, actually kind of like Polkadot when you think about it, but anyway. Really? Even there? Okay. Now it's... All right. Well, sorry. Please tell me earlier. Okay, so this was the non-substrate way of thinking, and let's now look at the other side of the coin, the substrate way of thinking. We start with the opposite premise that both society and technology evolve, and things change. We build technology to meet the demands of society, and both sides of this equation are changing all the time. So it's like a very unstable ground to build upon. More importantly, we humans, the ones who are building this technology, are very much capable of making mistakes and oftentimes do make mistakes or make the wrong choices. Therefore, a very grim, but in my opinion, enlightening fact that whatever we build today is, it's only a matter of time. It has a time limit. It's only a matter of time before what we build today is a mistake or something that is dated. So A, I think this is an interesting mindset to, you can apply it to life, not just blockchains and substrate. But secondly, I think it's particularly important to keep this in mind when you're building blockchain systems, because blockchain systems are very different in terms of software development than let's building a website or a mobile application or whatever, because you're building these systems that are value-bearing. They're supposed to last many years. They're supposed to host functions of society, so on and so forth. So the stakes are really high. So it's even more important to design the system from scratch, from the very beginning, such that it can survive the test of time. And I think this mindset is exactly the solution to this dilemma. So these are the sort of the opposite way of thinking. And what consequences does it have? If we accept these few points, what are we going to do about it? And these are the what are we going to do about it part. Basically, substrate's answer to these problems. We choose Rust as a programming language. When we're programming substrate and then blockchains that are built with substrate, we keep things to the extent where it's reasonably possible, generic, modular, and extensible. And finally, we are very conscious of governance and upgradability. I'm going to explain each of them in a little bit more detail now. So, first about Rust, this is like our first line of defense. No matter what software artifact you're going to code, You want to make sure you make as little mistakes in it as possible. You want to minimize human error in writing program. And Rust is exactly a language that is meant for that. All those borrow checking errors that you have seen. Maybe like a question. How many people before coming here were familiar with Rust? Okay, maybe like half or so. So there was quite a few of you that have seen Rust only recently. So I'm guessing that these errors and these compiler idiosyncrasies are new for you. So all of that is because Rust is a safe language, it's a memory safe language that prevents a lot of errors from happening at runtime when your code is actually executing, and it actually catches them at compile time. So it's much more difficult to compile code, but then when you run it, it's much better. This all goes back to memory safety. I have a simple memory example of it here. A few lines of C code where you very easily can create a dangling pointer, and then this will, this will become a very notorious issue further down the road. And the equivalent code in Rust doesn't even compile. You can try this later on your own, and there's more example again in the speaker notes. Am I audible, by the way?
Yeah.
Okay, that's good. Getting used to it. Those who follow like the security space, like all of these vulnerabilities coming out and so on, probably know that many of them still go back to memory safety. Actually, many of them, or when I was following this space a little bit more, goes back to like buffer overflow, like the simplest thing in the world, where you allocate 10 bytes, don't copy 12 bytes in it. Like every programmer you think knows this, but believe it or not, most of the vulnerabilities in our devices, when someone can get root access on your Android device and so on, goes back to this basic issues. So memory safety is like extremely important. And based on some studies and research and stuff, apparently 70% of vulnerabilities go back to it. So Rust provides memory safety, and that's great. And it provides a lot of abstractions as well. That's great. Like, like Java, C Sharp, you have generics, you have traits, you have all these things. But importantly, crucially, all of these abstractions are zero cost. As in, it's all some fluff for compiler to better understand you. But then when a binary is generated and that code is actually being executed, there is no additional overhead on your binary, almost no overhead. As in, a Rust binary is almost as fast as a C or C++ binary. And that's great, because we want to develop systems. We want our blockchain systems developed with Rust to be safe, and we want to use these nice abstractions, but crucially, we don't want them to be slow. So I have the word runtime here, because we have the word runtime in the context of Substrate as well. I want to first ask a question of like, what do we mean? Does anyone know what we mean by runtime in a general sense in programming context? How does it work? Usually we throw the mic around, or you just?
Yeah.
So then please.
All right, I'm going to take a shot at this here. So runtime from my own experience just means when the program is basically running. You have compile time and then runtime. Compile time is more or less when you compile your code. Runtime is when you run your code.
Yes. And I think a little bit more detail to it, usually it also refers to the piece of code that compiler injects into your main function or whatever to make your program compile. So programs that have a runtime, for example, programs that have like garbage collector, that's like a lot of code that the compiler puts next to your main function artificially to collect your memory garbage for you. Programs, languages that don't produce a runtime are typically just your main code with maybe a little bit extra. So this has nothing to do with Substrate. I just kind of explained it because in Substrate the word runtime is used, and unfortunately is used in a completely different completely different meaning. So I thought just knowing the definition of runtime outside of Substrate would help you better put the boundary. Better understand that runtime means something slightly different in Substrate. Okay, so that was about Rust. Now Substrate is coded in a generic, modular, and extensible design. This is like the second line of defense. So let's say whatever thing we code, thanks to Rust, is safe and or memory safe, and there's few errors in it and so on. But then you have this situation where you want to, for example, you don't know which database you want to put in your system. So you cannot design it generically. So you can easily swap from database A to database B easily without needing to change like, you know, a million lines of code. You can do it with just like one. Or like your hash type or your account ID type. So Substrate is full of this mindset. That's basically what I want to get at. And you will see examples of it both in Substrate and also in Frame. So a couple of examples of this. Consensus engines in Substrate. You, from your blockchain module, you already know roughly what consensus is in a blockchain. There's multiple examples, components already ready to be used in Substrate. It ships with Substrate. I have a few of them named here. Based on your knowledge of the space, you might, some of them might be familiar. If not, just know that this is a list of consensus engines that you can plug into your Substrate blockchain by just changing, you know, one or a few lines of code. And they're very different. You know, you have proof of work, you have this babe, grandpa, and so on that usually work based on proof of stake. So, you know, it's very flexible. Similarly, the networking transport protocol can be easily swapped. You can use Quick, you can use TCP. There's multiple databases that come with Substrate. Again, it's like a CLI like this one. You can easily select, hey, use RocksDB or use this other one developed by Parity that's more efficient for blockchains called ParityDB. You'll learn about all these things, some of them later, but some of them are just references. You can read up on them online. The transaction pool in Substrate is very generic as well. You will have a lecture on this. And as I mentioned, some of these primitive types, like account ID, what is your cryptography signatures, what is your even block number type? You know, do you want to use U32 or U64 for your block number? All these things can be easily configured. And a few examples of blockchains that are built with Substrate and are utilizing exactly these properties. Guys from Aleph Zero were here this week, so I guess you kind of know them. But you can look up these projects later. Okay, and finally, let's say we do everything that I just said, as in like we program or we have this software artifact that's very generic and modular and we can easily change things. I'm going to actually argue that it's not that useful if you can't agree on what that change should be. Remember, this is in the context of a blockchain ecosystem. Decisions are made usually or ideally collaboratively in a democratic way or something similar to democracy. So all of this is still not super useful if you don't have these two components, governance and upgradability. So governance is basically the ability to then decide what change you want to apply. Do you want to go from account ID type 1 to 2 or whatever? Like you want to go from, I don't know, hash function A to B, whatever that change is going to be, what is it actually going to be? How are you going to make that decision? Or how is your blockchain ecosystem going to make that decision? And finally, when that decision is made, how are you going to enact that as an upgrade? How is that upgrade going to happen? So this is why governance and upgradability is very important in Substrate, and it's emphasized heavily in Substrate, and it's an integral part of it. So I kind of covered this, that's fine. And between governance and upgradability, I'm actually going to argue that governance is easier. Like, end of the day, there are many ways to have on-chain or off-chain voting systems. You know, people either based on their token or based on some ranking, based on their experience, whatever they vote, and you can tally those votes and eventually come up to a decision about whatever it was that you were voting. What's actually difficult is upgradability. So I'm going to actually pause here and again ask a question. How does a blockchain, based on everything you've learned so far, upgrade itself? What is the process? Fork. Which, explain a bit, who said fork? Yes, tell a bit further. And I want you to focus on, so imagine this blockchain is Bitcoin, and I'm a miner. What do I see? What do I do?
I think it depends on the kind of change. If you increase the block size or you decrease the block size, you can have retrocompatibility or not. So there's these types of forks, but it's the first thing that came in my mind.
Okay.
So the types of forks.
So some upgrades are backwards compatible, yeah, some are not. We can, so then let's take that further. If it's backward compatible, I do nothing. Although there might be a deadline to it, right? Usually features or something gets, sometimes things are backward compatible, but with a deadline. And if it's not backward compatible, what do I have to do? I would need to upgrade. Yeah. I would need to, you know.
Yeah, expand.
There's like this set time where, you know, hopefully everyone has to upgrade by then or exactly at like that time.
The majority of other miners migrating to this new version or not. Yes. And in this way you are ended up with forks of different versions of the protocol.
Yeah. So if the protocol is very, let me replay that. If the protocol is, let's say, very naive, people start upgrading and two forks form, and eventually the upgraded fork wins because majority is running that new one. But it can even be a bit like nicer. There could be this transitionary binary that kind of supports both, and you run this, and I don't know, at a fixed block, it flips. I think actually that's how Ethereum does it. But yeah, it's the point I want to get to is that no matter what we do, there's still this human element. Like, let's say Bitcoin had like on-chain voting where all Bitcoin holders voted on every governance or every upgrade or whatever. Like it's still all kind of at the mercy of these miners doing the thing that they're supposed to do correctly, or these off-chain coordinations. And I'm going to show now how Substrate does this and fix or significantly improve the situation. So first, a visualization of what this example that we talked about is. I think the problem with this forkful example is that the whole protocol is like one big software artifact. It's like one monolithic protocol or software, whatever you want to call it. And when you want to change it, you change the whole thing. Like there's no boundary in it. So you go from Bitcoin to some other coin. Like this is how an upgrade happens. And I'm going to, this is my proposal, that the way to make a protocol upgradable is actually to separate, put a boundary in it. Say part of it becomes a meta protocol that is more fixed. It's the part that changes less. And part of it becomes an upgradable protocol. So let me now show you how a substrate-based blockchain looks like. It's kind of exactly what I said. So the protocol is actually divided into two pieces. A meta protocol is more fixed. Its duty is to actually run the protocol itself, and the protocol itself is separated. And this brings me to the main architectural fact or design of Substrate, which is a separation. All Substrate-based chains are composed of two parts, a node and a runtime. And this is where the word runtime is reused, but it doesn't mean what we just said. It has a different meaning. I'll get to it. A Substrate node is the part of the blockchain that you don't want to change it as frequently. It's like the networking code that, you know, no one cares about in every 10 year or whatever, or the database that is fixed and, you know, someone writes it and it doesn't change as frequently. And the runtime is the part of the blockchain that's actually the application logic, the part that people are interested in and want to change and want it to be flexible and upgradable and so on. And then this allows, actually, no, I need to add one more fact here. So you learned about contracts. What is a contract exactly? It's some code that is stored somewhere in a blockchain. The key to make this design upgradable is that the runtime is encoded as some bytecode and is actually stored as a part of the blockchain. And we use WebAssembly here, ink contracts. So the runtime of a substrate-based chain is encoded as WebAssembly and is actually kept as a part of the state of the blockchain. And then the main responsibility of the node side, is actually to just run whatever that WebAssembly was encoding. And then the upgrade process becomes very easy. You know, the runtime itself can signal to the node, hey, upgrade me to this other thing, and then you replace that code with something else. Yes.
So just to sort of understand, so the runtime, like changes to the code of Substrate, mm-hmm. would result in different WASM files, basically, right?
Yeah, we'll go into this, or changes to the runtime, not... if you want to change the runtime, it's merely changing WASM A to WASM B. We have an example of this that comes...
it's just because you were talking about upgradability. Yes. We're talking about upgradability of the... Well, basically, yeah, bumping up a version of Substrate or not.
Do you mean the node or a particular runtime?
I'm not sure. Because you say governance and upgradability. We're talking about Substrate right now, right?
Yes, but at this point we have a division. So we have any blockchain produced with Substrate is composed of a node and a runtime.
Oh, so we're talking about upgrades to the chain.
Yes.
That is built.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Governance upgradability of chains built with Substrate, not Substrate itself.
Okay.
Well, I mean, Substrate itself is an open source project. I guess you can kind of like.
Okay, so then upgrades to the chain would lead to. Let me just carry on. And,
so, yeah, save it for the until the end of the lecture. I'm pretty sure I will answer that.
Yeah, I would like to. This remembers me a lot. My old times programming in the Java virtual machine, where you have like a software that is running a software inside it.
Exactly.
And some virtual machines, like for example the Erlang virtual machines, have these capabilities of changing on the fly without having to reboot or restart the system. This is more or less
it resembles very clearly. One more at the somewhere. Hello? Yeah.
So what happens if different nodes run different runtimes? I didn't understand.
The different nodes will not run different runtimes because I will get to this again in further detail. I've so far just hinted at it or said it once verbally. But the runtime is encoded as a WebAssembly blob that is part of your blockchain state. If two nodes have two different states, they're basically on different forks. You know, it's kind of like two nodes saying, one of them saying, I have 10 bitcoins, and one of them saying, I have one bitcoin. Like, there are two different forks.
So there's still a fork?
You're saying, what if two nodes run two different runtimes? I'm saying, if they do that, yes, one of them is clearly on a fork. Yes.
Hello, Johan here. It's not clear for me, the node, the purple node, it's also a WebAssembly runtime that is running a WebAssembly runtime that can load WebAssembly contracts and something to be executed.
So I think this is a good time for me to continue my slides, because in the next slide I will answer exactly what is node and what is runtime. I think this will answer this question as well.
Okay.
So let's continue, and you should also keep your question in mind. It will be answered in a few minutes at most. So this I already covered. So exactly, what is like a meta protocol here? It's the node whose main duty is to run the runtime. It's like, hey, here's this WASM blob, whatever it is, run it. That's your main job. And what is the upgradable protocol itself? It's whatever the runtime is encoding. Again, kind of similar to contracts. So this is a very simplified diagram of Substrate. It's basically saying the same thing, that it's divided into two pieces, a node and a runtime, and the fact that the runtime is encoded as WebAssembly. And the arrows are representing the fact that there's communication between the two. But we will learn more about that communication later in the slide or tomorrow. But to your question, so a little bit more specific details. So what did I just say again? What was this runtime again? What was this node? Let's go over like a list format. I think this will help. So the runtime is basically your application logic. It's the part of the blockchain that you want it to be customizable, or you want it way more for most users to be customizable. If, for example, your blockchain is Bitcoin, your application logic is that simple. It's only doing addition, subtraction, and you know that's basically it. If you're Ethereum, your application logic is something like the EVM virtual machine. Like, you should be capable of receiving contracts, interpreting them, executing them, and so on. The runtime is encoded as WebAssembly, but it could be produced with any thing that can produce WebAssembly. In this module, you're actually going to write a runtime without Frame. Next week, you will learn to produce your runtime using Frame. And crucially, the runtime, this WASM blob, is stored as a part of your blockchain state, like in the same database, in the same bucket of data where you store what is my balance and what is his balance. There's also a pointer that you can go to and from which you can find your blockchain runtime code. And finally, another name for the runtime is state transition function. Again, I think the Substrate ecosystem, kind of like a off-the-record comment, is kind of notorious for having lots of keywords and like the jargon is a bit heavy. And in these lectures, I don't try and like let's say censor them away, but I try to give you all the names. I will use the word runtime, but another name for it that you might find in documentation and so on is state transition function. Okay, so this was about the runtime, and now the node, the meta protocol, what is it? To your question, the node is a native binary, like as in it's like a normal binary that is produced from the programming language Rust based on the operating system and the architecture of the CPU. Its main duty is to execute the WebAssembly blob, which is the runtime. That is the main thing that it does, but next to it, it also does a lot of other things that are not really relevant to the application logic of your blockchain, such as handling networking processes, database access, transaction pool. What else do I have here? Consensus as well. These are all the things that are not part of the runtime, and they are handled by the node side. Hopefully, I answered that question now. Two more synonyms for the node is also the word host and client. I think especially the word client, you will see it a lot, but I am doing my best to migrate all the documents, or let's say use the word node as much as I can, because most people agree node is a better word for it. Yes?
Is there a way to make an analogy here, like, for example, to the JVM concept that would make us, that would help us understand this? Like, if we say, like, let's say runtime in this example is the JVM, then what is the node? Is this even applicable?
Yeah, let me give you a few analogies. For the Java-based applications, the JVM let's skip the Java one. I think I have a better one. It's at the end of this lecture as a recap, but let's jump into it. So, Substrate node is kind of like the game console, and the runtime is like the thing you put in it, and it's a specific game. I think this is the absolute best one.
Yeah.
Yeah?
Okay, so like to reword it, basically like the logic of the application is derived from the blockchain, right? Like the runtime is derived from the blockchain because it lives.
I wouldn't
on the blockchain.
Even use the word derived. The runtime is the blockchain.
It lives. Okay. Yeah.
Is
the blockchain, and okay, cool. And then the node is responsible for running it.
Yes.
And exactly. Okay.
Yes. You pass the.
One slide backwards, please. Here. You listed consensus in the node. That means that we cannot upgrade consensus. We cannot fork or not fork the consensus. We cannot change it.
So the consensus cannot be upgraded fork like in the same way that the runtime can be upgraded. I haven't gotten to this part yet. Like the node side, I think it kind of goes back to the answer that we had with the gentleman behind you. If you have a substrate-based chain and you want to upgrade the node, if it's backwards compatible, well, you just upgrade it, nothing happens, whatever. But if it's a breaking change, you want to go from, like, I don't know, proof of stake to proof of work, then it follows the same difficulties that upgrading other blockchains would do. So your point is, to your point, yes. If you want to upgrade consensus in a breaking way, it's a forkful, it's a forky, I don't know, like it will require some difficulties. But let's say you want to upgrade something in your runtime, that is a very different process.
Okay, thank you.
You pass it behind you.
So in this case, we have multiple nodes, and each node will have multiple runtimes?
Oh, no, there's just one.
One node?
No, I mean, there's just one runtime.
One runtime on one node?
No, on all nodes, but yeah. Let me go a bit further.
Continue.
Let me go. I'm pretty sure I can. Let's save it a little bit. And I think if I progress, like, I've so far given a lot of facts, but I think less explanation. Let me go through a few more slides. I think I can answer a lot of these questions. So what are some of the good things about using this WebAssembly meta protocol, so using WebAssembly and so on? WebAssembly is a deterministic bytecode, meaning that, you know, we can, if different people execute on different machines, it reaches the same outcome. That's great. That's like a requirement of all blockchain systems. You want determinism. Great. We move on. Similarly, just a little detail, WebAssembly gives you good sandboxing properties. You just learned about ink and how we have WebAssembly smart contracts as well, especially if you want to use WebAssembly in the context of smart contracts. You're basically executing foreign code, code that you cannot really trust. If it's like, what is it doing? Is it going to delete my, you know, file system? Is it going to try and get root access on my computer? Whatever this code is going to do. So sandboxing is pretty useful, especially in the context of smart contract, which you learned. And later you will learn about parachains in the Polkadot module. There we're also dealing with untrusted code. So again, sandboxing is useful. Another property of using this WebAssembly meta protocol is that developing alternative nodes is a bit easier. So let's say, you have a blockchain that's built with Substrate. The default node that Substrate gives you is this Rust node binary. Now, if someone, a team, wants to develop a Go client for that blockchain, they only have to re-implement the node side. They don't really have to re-implement whatever is the runtime logic, because, you know, in the node, there is this logic that says, just spin up, give me a WebAssembly executor and execute this thing, and that's the runtime part. And finally, I hope this will answer the last question that I kind of dodged. The benefit of having WebAssembly as a meta protocol is that you get these forkless upgrades. So as I said, you have the runtime, and it's part of the state, as in, OK, let me pause. Is it clear what I mean by state? The blockchain state, you know, the set of data upon which we want to come to consensus. What is account balances? What are contracts? Whatever. In your state, associated with, let's say, block N, you have the state associated with block N, and in there, there's some WebAssembly blob, and that is my canonical runtime at block N. So that's, now let's say through the process of going from block N to N plus one, some transaction or some part of the system decides to change this thing in the state. So now from block N plus one onwards, your runtime has just changed. And let's actually take a moment to really understand two things, that this upgrade was forkless and it was self-enacting. So I asked this question about like how other ecosystems and other blockchains go about upgrading themselves, and I wanted to really point out this point of time where a miner, a validator, a node operator has to go and like stop the old binary and start a new one, and you know, you have to do it at the right time. In this process, in this forkless upgrade, if I'm a miner, if I'm a validator, I don't do anything. I don't even realize an upgrade happened, because I'm doing the same thing. As a node operator, as a validator, I'm doing the same thing. I'm running some software who's in charge of grabbing a WebAssembly blob from a runtime and executing it. I'm still doing the same thing. And this is why that meta protocol thing is useful, because the meta protocol changes infrequently, so most people don't need to care about it most of the time, and the protocol can upgrade as frequent as we want. So I hope this actually answers now a lot of questions. But again, I will show this process visually a little bit further in the slides. Let's take one more question. So from the previous cohorts, I can say the way to solve this problem is that if someone has the mic but forgets that they have the mic, they think they should be punished. Like we should have you get negative points. And once you get enough negative points, you have to buy, I don't know, something for the whole class.
Yeah, my name is Gunjan. And when we upgrade the runtime and then we have the state,
So when does the migration happens? So do we have some intermediate stage or?
This also comes in a further slide.
Okay,
so okay. Please save it.
I'll okay, answer. Thank you.
Yes?
Hello, I'm Sukhmeet. I think you can all buy breakfast. If as a punishment who forgets the mic, right? Because breakfast's free. So the other part, what is the runtime's relation to the parachain? Like what is parachain if the, once a node, once a runtime, then where does parachain comes in? Because you said blockchain can only have one runtime.
So in favor of time, I will answer that after class. Come to
Thank
me
you.
Or save it for the block for the Polkadot module. It's too ahead of time. Okay. Let's continue and please remember where the mic is. So this WASM WebAssembly meta protocol, blah, 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 it's not all, you know, rainbows and stuff. Let's be realistic. There are some negative consequences to it as well. First is that you're running some bytecode on a virtual machine, and no matter how awesome that virtual machine is, you're just going to have some less resources available to you. You are one step further from the hardware, so it's going to be a little bit of overhead. Now, this has gotten a lot better in the last few years. I think in the early days when I started, we were just using an interpreter for WebAssembly. It was called WASMI, developed by Parity, still used in the contract context, but this was like 10x slower than native at the time. I think it's much faster now. But then this notion of compiled WASM came with like WASM time and so on, and that was almost as fast as native. But nonetheless, you still have less memory given to you. You also, because of that sandboxing, you have limited access to operating systems. So, you know, the runtime cannot open a file and write some bytes to it. Although, again, the sandboxing is usually good, but it also comes with the fact that you just have limited access to operating system or your host. This node the ease of writing alternative nodes as well also has a flip side, as in node diversification doesn't mean runtime diversification. Now, actually, why do we want node diversification? Like, why do what? To what? Yeah, or what, a bug maybe, you know, like. Right, so if two node implementations exist, it's very unlikely for a bug to exist in both of them. This has happened in the past where I think the Parity Ethereum node got very famous because it survived, for example, one of those attacks. Like all the Geth nodes went down, but kind of like another implementation kept the network alive. But now we don't get that property for a runtime, right? Because if there's a bug in the runtime and the blockchain is going down, everyone goes down. Like as in, you know, there's no way to recover from it. Though there's every time with students I have had interesting discussions around how this can be alleviated. It's a bit of a hairy topic, but you could have then also multiple runtimes kind of stored, and then maybe one of them is the fallback for the other. But that's a very, very iffy topic. Let's maybe save it for an after-class discussion. And finally, one of the more recent downsides of WebAssembly that we are discovering is that metering is not great in WebAssembly. What do we mean by metering? Metering is the ability to kind of like meter how much a software, how much resources you have consumed as you're executing. So Ethereum has this, it's this gas price. Hopefully also in the Ink module, in the smart contract module, you have become familiar with this. Right? Like, can someone nod a little bit? Like metering, Yeah, but metering was discussed earlier this week, at least a little bit, right? No, okay. But gas price was, right? A gas price is basically metering. Every instruction has a gas price. Every time you execute that instruction, you add it to some accumulator, and that is basically metering. So this process of assigning gas price to different instructions is extremely, unfortunately, difficult in WASM, where it's like a complicated thing to do. Long story short, now the Polkadot ecosystem and Parity are exploring alternative virtual machines based on RISC-V. It's another VM. They call it PolkaVM now to improve this. You will learn more about metering and what is the alternative and how you do it in Substrate runtimes next week when you learn about Frame. It's called benchmarking lecture.
Quick one.
Yes.
Just to help us drill the concept in. Why are we generating a WASM file and not a binary? Like, is that just for multi-platformness? Like, why is the file that, like you say, the node like basically takes the WASM file, right, from the runtime, and does something with it, like runs it, talks with it, runs it, right? Like, so why?
The node gets the WASM blob from the state and runs it.
WASM blob.
Yes.
And what if it was a binary and not a WASM blob, just a executable?
Well, binaries are platform specific. That's the first thing that you don't
so
like
that's,
about.
Yeah, that's what I was going for. Like, is it mostly for the cross platformness?
Yes. Okay. And portability, right? You can also encode a binary and write it in some. It's still some bytes, but again, those bytes are not platform agnostic. They are platform dependent.
Yeah, so it's like platform. Yeah. So Java equivalent would be like a jar.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Cool. Got it.
I guess this is something I could, or you know, it should have been emphasized more when we talked about the keyword portable here. WASM is portable, as in it's some bytes you can transfer to any machine on any architecture, on any operating system, and it executes the same way and in deterministic ways. In a deterministic way. Okay. What is the state or status of light clients with Substrate? So Substrate-based blockchains, they come, luckily, with a light client out of the box. Let me also again ask again, with a raise of hand, light clients, clear what it is? Or a little bit, like at least you've heard. Yeah, okay. It was probably mentioned in the blockchain module. And so you know already a light client is basically like a, with things that you have learned today, it's an alternative node. You know, it's like that is doing the same thing. It's still executing a WASM blob, which is your runtime and so on, but it's not syncing the whole blockchain, it's only following the headers. Now, there is a light client implementation in the Substrate ecosystem. It's called Small Dot, because it's kind of targeted toward Polkadot, but it works for the majority of Substrate-based chains. And what's nice about it is that it's basically like everything I said so far, but the node itself is also so simple, so slim, because it's a light client, it's a light node, that the node can also compile to WASM. So Small Dot compared to Substrate kind of looks like this. It's the same architecture, it's the same program, except the node is doing less things. It's now a light node, and the node can also compile to WASM. And what amazing property we can get from this? Now we can actually embed the node in anything, because the node itself is compilable to WebAssembly, which is this very lightweight format. And to begin with, we can put it on a browser. A web page can run a light client node, a small dot node. Or we can put it in a mobile phone. Huh? Another chain. Sure, yeah. Yes. So this was just my sort of intro to Small Dot. It has amazing documentation. You can read about it. TLDR is that Substrate comes with a decent light client support, but it's named a little bit too much like Polkadot, so it's called Small Dot. And as I mentioned, Small Dot itself compiles to WebAssembly, so you can, the first use case that everyone's very interested in is you can put it in a browser very easily.
So, in one of the slides, you mentioned that the Polka VM is based on targeting RISC-V.
Yes.
So, why would it be processor-specific?
So RISC-V is also a virtual, like it's also like a instruction set, and you can write virtual machines for that
type of processors.
You can also have a VM that processes the same instruction set. It doesn't need to be hardware.
RISC-V doesn't need to be hardware.
Let me try again, but if not, let's again continue this after class. So RISC-V is a set of instructions, and you can have a CPU that is tailored toward executing only those instruction sets. What I'm trying to say is that you can also have a virtual machine that at the software level executes those and then translates them to whatever is the hardware. So you're not, RISC-V doesn't mean Polka VM is bound to a specific hardware. That's a TLDR.
Okay.
But if you have further questions, let's talk about it after class. Okay,
thanks.
Okay. I have not much slides left until like the end of at least the majority or the first big section of this lecture. So I'm a little bit also trying to now push through to make sure I finish not too late. So a few words about the communication path in this substrate diagram that we keep seeing over and over again. Let's first start with the simpler one. So external applications, people from the outer world, wallets, browsers, CLIs, whatever external software, they want to talk with the whole blockchain, and they usually do it through JSON RPC. So it's like some request that comes over WebSocket, HTTP, whatever, and it follows the JSON RPC spec. You have a lecture later today from my colleague Ankan who will explain this in further detail. And then I mentioned that the node and the runtime are also always talking to each other. And this will be the main topic of a lecture tomorrow. But for now, I want you to just know that, yes, there is communication. When the node talks to the runtime, we call it the runtime API. And when the runtime talks to the node, we call it a host function. I guess this is one of the reasons why the node is also referred to host. Would have been simpler if it was called node function, but the... Sorry? Host API. Yeah, there's many ways. The namings in Substrate ecosystem, honestly, this is what I learned over time. They come from the position of explaining things at the most accurate way that they are, not necessarily at how it's easier to understand. So that's why sometimes you get these keywords or these explanations that are or these like names that are a little bit less intuitive, but once you learn the details, they make more sense. So for example here, the word host comes from the WebAssembly ecosystem. Like in the WebAssembly, if you're searching or working with WebAssembly, very often when the WebAssembly blob wants to talk to its interpreter, it's called a host function. So you know, Substrate opted to also name it host functions for compatibility with that. But yeah, of course, it sometimes makes things a bit more difficult to understand. And in these two communication paths that I just talked about, when the node is talking to the outer world, as I said, it's using JSON RPC, which, as the name suggests, uses JSON as its encoding language. You all know it. When the node and the runtime talk to each other, they use a more specific encoding language that's called scale. This is a binary format to transfer data from one place to another, and there will be a lecture on this as well later today, so you will learn more about it. I'll just give a very brief example to demonstrate the difference between the two. So JSON is it's easy to understand, but it's also in text. Like it's very like it's not efficient. It's meant to be human readable. Like you know, so that already ruins efficiency. Let's say, I mean, if you want things to be efficient, you want to encode them in a binary way that no human can read it, but machines can read them fast. And scale is exactly that. Scale is like the opposite of JSON. It's binary. It's efficient. It's non-descriptive. As in, if you don't know what are these bytes, you're not going to be able to do anything about them. But it's extremely efficient, and we prefer to use it when we care about efficiency. I have an example here. There's a Rust struct, and we instantiate it. The struct has a couple of fields. We instantiate it, and we first encode it with scale. And as you see, it's kind of yielding, hopefully you can also see at the bottom, it's yielding only 7 bytes, and these 7 bytes are only the values that were in the struct, you know, 42, and then 1 is representing a true, and then a 69. And if I encode the same struct as JSON, you will see that it's much more human readable. You actually get the name of the fields and so on, but it's 42 bytes. So that's just like an example to demonstrate the trade-off that we have. Yes.
Why did you choose, Substrate builders chose to use scale and not something like protobuf or?
So protobuf specifically, I think this will be covered in the next lecture right away.
Okay.
But I will tell you what I know about it because I'm not sure if and to what extent it will be covered. Protobuf specifically, I think, has some undeterministic element to it. I think that's what I. But end of the day, yes, it like. what we want is a efficient binary protocol to encode data and then decode it back. And there could have been other options. Parity develops scale to meet these needs, but you know, I think. Oh yeah, that's also another thing. So scale is, for example, being non-descriptive is very convenient because Rust is a type language where both parties communicating with one another must know each other's types very often. So it's also very. Is protobuf like more like descriptive, more like JSON, or is it also binary?
No, it's binary, like protobuf.
It's also binary,
protobuf
but
and Avro, like there are multiple binary formats. Yeah, yeah. I was interested why like build their own stuff, not use something that's already there. Yeah. But
I think over time I was. Yes. Can you?
All right. So, if it sounds like if there's any sort of issue with the question, let me know. But what's the difference between scale and BCS, and why don't we use BCS encoded for our communication paths for Substrate?
So you gotta explain to me what you mean by BCS or
BCS binary canonical serialization, more or less. Are you familiar with that?
No.
Okay.
So it's
that's fine.
I can't answer.
That's fine.
Do you want to add something or? Okay. So, with these things, come to me after class. I'm happy to learn. But yeah, given that I don't know, I can't add anything. So, can't move on. Sure.
They don't use that because once you go with scale, the next version of scale will be an issue for everything that's encoded before with that. So you have to re-encode everything.
Not sure if I got that, but maybe you can paraphrase that.
Yes, so Mark is the non mentioned just binary. Binary canonical serialization stands for BCS, which is particularly specific to the Libra project from Facebook. So they created their own data format to encode messaging that is highly compressed. Scale, on the contrary, focuses a bit more on diagnostic message passing. So,
okay, yeah. Thank you. I can just give one more anecdote as well. Over the years, I was presented by friends or people that I know that are familiar with other ecosystems that asked a similar question. I think someone showed me, like, I forgot which other blockchain, but specifically one other, maybe it was from Solana, I don't know. But like, this is a thing that Blockchain X is using. I know Polkadot is using Scale. What is the difference? And I asked the same question. Well, I'm not familiar with the other thing, but when they explain it, it's almost very much similar. Very often it's similar, what we can conclude from that is also that this was made in 2017 or whatever. Like at the time, maybe there wasn't much better or that many better options, many more options, especially in Rust or for Rust. Also, keep in mind, like Parity and Parity Ethereum were like the pioneers of bringing Rust to blockchain. So they kind of had to come up with things that maybe over time is no longer, let's say, unique, or other projects may have adopted similar things. Hindsight is 2020. Yeah, I'm not sure if I understand that, sorry. Hindsight is 2020.
Exactly.
Possibly. There is things evolve and not everything might be at the edge of technology. I cannot claim everything here is, But again, I'm please share what you know. And for example, if you have a comparison with scale with me, or even better in the big chat so we can all see and we can all learn. So, okay. Moving on, Substrate and smart contracts. So if you're interested in building blockchains that are executing smart contracts, either be it ink and WebAssembly based or WASM and Solidity based, Substrate at the runtime level, so in frame, which you will learn about next week. I can just give you a preview that already comes with prepackaged modules that are capable of executing both EVM and WebAssembly contracts. So you can very easily make your runtime capable of executing these contract formats. And then you also have this interesting situation. I think someone in their question leaned into it. Then what's really happening there? Like the runtime itself is a WASM blob that's executing, it's like ingesting and executing another WASM blob, which is like a WebAssembly contract. Kind of interesting when you think about it. And you can even take it a step further. Then you have like the small dot, which can run in the browser, and it's in itself a WASM blob. You can have three. I'll get to that later. So specifically for EVM, I added this actually just today, wasn't part of the lecture. There's this other tool, which is pretty cool, at the bottom. It's called Frontier. What it does is it's a wrapper around Substrate node and JSON RPC functions, and it mimics Ethereum's JSON RPC functions. So if you have a runtime that has this palette that can execute EVM contracts, you have a runtime that is very similar to Ethereum's state transition function, and you have a Substrate node that's also capable of responding to Ethereum-style JSON RPC requests, and then you can basically have you can recreate something that is very similar to Ethereum with Substrate with very little extra coding, or it's already all the pieces are already there. You just have to glue them together. So you have this situation, as in like you have a blockchain that looks like it's Ethereum, but when you actually look under the hood, it's a Substrate-based blockchain that is mimicking Ethereum, or it's implementing Ethereum. Remember, Substrate is a framework. You can build anything in it, and this is an example. Or these two tools that I have here, this palette EVM, which you'll learn about more next week, and this Frontier are the main tools that you can use to build something like Ethereum with Substrate. And this was the thing I wanted to talk about, I already hinted at. So you have small dot syncing or running in a browser. How many WASM, nested WASM blobs do we have here? Three, right? So it's like small dot, which is itself this light node that is encoded as WebAssembly and lives in the browser. It's executing some runtime that is itself a WASM blob, and that runtime is executing another WASM blob, which is a WebAssembly-based contract. So it's kind of crazy that this works, but it actually works. Yes, I mean, you can. Actually, there was a guy in Parity, Pierre. He's actually the guy developing small dots. He has somewhere in his GitHub like a WASM-based operating system. Like, so you can even, yes, you can have five, I think. Yes, five is already imaginable, but you can take it further. So final comment about this. This is a pretty important topic or important question to ask. I will answer it now, but I think you should keep this question in mind and revisit it throughout the rest of this week and especially next week as well. So when should you build a blockchain or build your own runtime? And when should you build a contract? Does anyone want to answer this? Can we have the mic here?
I guess the smart contract approach gives you less power, less configurability, etc. But faster development, and the opposite for
yes.
A runtime. Yeah.
I think you covered the main points that I wanted to get at. I'll just just look at it from a different angle. I think So first, to paraphrase, smart contracts are easier but are less powerful. That's the TLDR. If you build your own blockchain or build your own runtime, it's more powerful, it's more difficult. But what we've learned over the years, and I wanted to emphasize, which is not a new fact, it's just a different way to look at what you already said, is that from a business or let's keep it at that. From a business point of view, it usually makes sense to think about first smart contract as if that's all you can build. Until you hit a wall, and then think about next. I think we've seen projects fail because of doing the opposite. You know, you shouldn't if you're going to go maximum speed of, let's say, 10 kilometers per hour, you don't need a fancy car. A bicycle is enough. You can think of it this way. And the smart contract is the bicycle in this example. But if you are, or assuming you follow the trajectory of, you know, starting with a contract, what's next? Usually what we foresee is that you start with like a contract. If it's in the Rust and Parity's toolkit ecosystem, you start with ink, and then eventually you kind of graduate into having your own palettes or your own runtime, which can at some point become a Polkadot parachain. But this is just a kind of a preview of things that you'll learn more about. So again, like the main, I guess my best answer to this question, this previous question, is that a team, an idea, should always start being implemented as a contract and test it on, like, you know, there's all of these cheap contract platforms out there. You can easily deploy on them with few cents or, I don't know, dollars, whatever. So you should prototype it there, and then you can take it to the next level if needed. So different ways of going about developing with Substrate. You have broadly three options. You can either take Substrate-based templates where they're usually configured for a particular use case. I'm starting from the left side, so templates in a broad sense. These give you least amount of development freedom. So it's a template, you might be able to tweak some parameters or whatever, but it's already made. Like, it's like a template that has, I don't know, a bunch of NFT functionality in it. And if you're like a typical NFT chain, this template is for 95% of the time what you need. This is the easiest. Next step is that you can then, for example, add your own modules to the runtime. This will be what you will learn next week, to develop your custom runtime, learn frame, and then, you know, write a custom frame-based runtime. Or the tech-savvy ones or the teams that need it can also tweak Substrate at the core level. This is going even beyond the runtime and, for example, tweaking, we had a question about consensus, for example, tweaking the consensus mechanism of Substrate, or adding something that doesn't exist, or generally speaking, you know, hacking at the Substrate core or node level. I think Aleph Zero is actually who was the team that was present here, and if they're still around, they're one of the teams that have actually chosen the rightmost path. They have their own consensus implementation that they have added to Substrate and so on. So all of these are possibilities. I think for most people, it's like frame and templates, though, for most projects.
Regarding Aleph Zero, so they're not actually running a parachain.
Yes.
Running their own blockchain, which uses Substrate as a framework.
So Substrate is, so far I actually haven't said anything about Substrate and how, actually in reality you can't use Substrate alone as a parachain. I'll get to this in a further slide, but for now when I say blockchains built with Substrate, I don't mean parachains at all. I mean blockchains. Like, yeah. Yeah. Which, and Aleph Zero is exactly one of them. They are not a parachain, they are we call them solo chains or sovereign chains. Actually, well, it happened to
the
be the
chain.
Yes. Right. It actually happened to be the next slide. So, Substrate and Polkadot, how they relate to.
So technically, we could choose any existing blockchain, like for example Bitcoin, and we could run a node of Bitcoin in Substrate if you implement the specific stuff that the Substrate doesn't.
Yeah, that would be. That would be similar to writing a Rust implementation for Bitcoin. Rust plus WASM, kind of. But people have already done that. I think actually Parity has done it years ago as well, like writing a Bitcoin client in Rust. But yeah, it's possible what you're saying. Okay, Substrate and Polkadot. So the options that Substrate give you, let's start from the left. You have like Bitcoin as an example. Actually, again, like very good time for your question. Good coincidence. You can build sovereign chains, or we call them solo chains, with Substrate, like Bitcoin, like whatever is your blockchain. And this blockchain has nothing to do with Polkadot. It will happily live on its own, and you know, it needs its own consensus. If it's proof of work, it will need to convince a bunch of people to spend electricity on it. If it's proof of stake, it needs to convince a bunch of people to bring their capital to the table to make it secure, whatever. You can build any sovereign blockchain with Substrate. In fact, Polkadot itself, not the parachains, just Polkadot, the relay chain, is just a Substrate-based chain. it has nothing special to it. It has extra components, so it's using Substrate at this like most tech-savvy level. It's tweaking Substrate at the core level to, you know, bring all the parachain protocol details that it wants. But at the base of it, if you look at like a Substrate template that is like just a basic blockchain, and you look at the Polkadot node implementation, you can see the mapping. You can see the folder structure is the same. It's the same project type. It's everything is the same. Now, when will Substrate be useful for parachains? This is the rightmost box. So there's this other software developed by Parity called Cumulus. This is like a wrapper for Substrate that will make a Substrate-based chain become a Polkadot parachain. So Substrate on its own is actually not like parachain-enabled. You need this other wrapper around it called Cumulus. And this will be taught not next week, but the week after that. So I hope this is also a slide that will answer a lot of questions. A small word about like the repository structure that we have here. This is actually new compared to the last cohort of PBA. And before we had like there was a repo called Substrate, there was a repo called Cumulus. Frame and XCM were kind of mixed or part of Substrate. And there was a repo called Polkadots. So they were all in different repositories. Fairly recently, these have all been merged into one repository called Polkadot SDK. I have a link to it here. You can go check it out and see all the components. And finally, you'll learn about this more in the Polkadot module, but only the runtimes of Polkadot, they live in a separate repository. And this is more because of governance reasons. The Polkadot SDK repository is owned by Parity Tech, and Parity is not the owner of, let's say, the Polkadot runtime or doesn't want to be the owner, so the runtimes live elsewhere. I think you will need, or you want to play around with like this Polkadot SDK repository for the rest of this module, or generally speaking, and this is like a massive code base. So it's a good idea to clone it and build it, so you have most of the build artifacts cached on your computer. So it doesn't take like 40 minutes to compile, it takes like 4 minutes. Can we pass the mic there?
The fellowship runtime, so this is a repo that has all, or not all, like a lot of block. When we say runtime here, it's the blockchain in the end, right? It's the new WASM, I mean, like the thing, but it is the what distinguishes this blockchain from the others, right? Yeah. So this has different blockchains in theory.
Yeah, in this repository, you have Polkadot relay chain runtime, you have Kusama relay chain runtime, you have all the system chains, but again, you'll learn about this stuff later. For now, I just want to distinguish that these things are owned in a repository called Polkadot SDK, owned by Parity. These things are not owned by Parity. I think that's the most important thing to know for now. Key.
Top of your head, do you know how many runtimes are there in total?
10. Maybe more.
Thanks.
Yeah, in the fellowship. All right, so this we already covered. I think it's a very good analogy. Okay, so I have just like, let's say, like one column of slides left. It's an example of how the runtime collaborates with the node and how it's upgraded. I can either continue and hopefully finish by 3:30, or we can take like a 10, 12 minute break and then resume. Maybe by show of hand, how many people really feel they need a break? I would rather continue, but just getting a vibe check. Okay. Yes, consensus. All right, so let's use one example to learn this like whole Substrate architecture, WebAssembly meta protocol further. And for that, I'm going to talk about the state transition function, why we call the runtime the state transition function. So let's dissect this word apart. What do I mean by state transition function? The first word in it is state. And hopefully, or luckily, it seems like everyone's familiar with that. But just a quick recap, what do we mean by state? State is a lot of data, usually represented as key value, like the ones I have here. That is everything that the blockchain wants to come to consensus about. Usually it's some account balances, some other critical data, but it could contain whatever. The important point is that the state is also associated with a block. Like you have the state of block 1 million, and then the state of block 1 million plus 1, and 2, and 3. Like its state is something that evolves over time. Usually if you don't specify state at which block, you mean at the latest block. An interesting point about state is also that keeping it is optional. Most blockchain nodes throw away old states. And the reason for that, I think, is worthy of being repeated, because state can always be derived from the blocks. You can always re-execute the blocks. You can always re-execute the first 100 blocks of Bitcoin and come up with the state of block 100. So you kind of don't need to actually keep all the old states. Or there's a trade-off. You can keep the old states, but then you're storing more data, or you can throw away the data and always re-execute. So that's what we mean by state. And what do we mean by transition function? What enables the state to transition from something to something else is two pieces of data. One is a new block, and that new block usually has some transactions, like transfer from Bob to Kian, whatever. And you need a way to know how to interpret that block, like what to do with it, like what is the function that dictates how you execute the block, and that happens to be the beloved runtime that we have been talking about in this entire lecture, this WASM runtime of ours. So in a bit of a math format, the state transition function is basically this. You can have a look yourself and see if it makes sense. Mike?
Why the function receives blocks n plus 1 and not block n to create the next state?
So we can receive block n, but then state and code needs to be n minus 1. So in order, like block n plus 1 leads to the next state.
Okay, is the block of the next state.
It's the next block.
The next
first
block.
Unexecuted block. I mean, I can call all of them N or...
So I take the current state,
yes.
The code that interprets this state, and
the next unexecuted block. Yeah, I mean, the N or M plus 1 doesn't matter. What matters is that it's a first unexecuted block. Actually, you also pointed out what I have in my speaker notes, as there is a small mistake in this. Which is that the code of block n is part of state n. So actually it's kind of duplicate, but anyways. Okay, so how does the state transition look like? It looks like this. I'm going to pause again and give you like a couple of seconds to interpret it yourself. Then I'll explain it. Is this big enough? So you always start with some state that is already known, and I haven't said it explicitly, but hopefully you have derived it yourself. Part of that state is some code. There is a key in my state that is literally called code, and the value associated with that key is some bytes that is a WebAssembly blob. You have a new incoming block, n plus 1, or as we fleshed out, the first unexecuted block, the first block that, or the new block that I haven't executed yet. And the arrows are kind of showing the function situation here. You have your WebAssembly runtime, which is the state transition functions. The inputs to this function are the previous state, the new block, and then this WASM runtime will produce a new state that is my new state. Right? And in this case, we had like a simple transfer here, 5 from Bob to Kian, so Kian and Bob both become 15. Right? This should be like 100% clear. It's just demonstrating the same. You've learned in the blockchain module. I actually checked this with Joshi, how blockchains are state machines. You have like states, you go from one state. This is just demonstrating the same thing, but it's adding this detail that in runtime, in substrate, the state transition function, the thing that dictates how you go from one state to the next, is this WebAssembly runtime. And it's part of the state itself. So really, really make sure this is clear to you. It's important. Yes?
Can I just walk it through, right? So you have a block N, and it has a given particular code. So then this goes through the WASM runtime, which is going to go ahead and look at the previous block and the code, and then observe the new block, N plus 1. And then we're saying that the WASM runtime then, I guess, updates the state, right?
Yeah.
Okay, got it.
Yep.
All right, okay, thank you.
That was a good replay, but everything correct.
I just want to want to be sure I understood. So if, for example, in the next block will be an update in the code itself.
That's sorry. Please continue. But
so we could also have like state transitions, like transactions changing balances, and also an update of the code itself. So
yes.
It will be just a change of parameters that will produce a new block with the new code of the runtime code and the new states.
Yes. So
new state of the whole block.
So let me first explain this, then I will incorporate your question as well. This should now be also like, actually, hopefully by this point, it's actually too simple as an, oh yeah, of course, Kian, we understand this. Go on to the next slide. But the same way that a block can contain a transaction that transfers some money from my account to your account can also contain a transaction or whatever other piece of logic that will say to the previous runtime, this like 1, 2, 3 runtime, hey, please update me to something new now. And then from block N plus 1 onwards, the new code is going to be used. His question, if I've understood correctly, was that in this block N plus 1, where we are doing this code upgrade, can I also have some transfers and whatever? And the answer is yes, it's executed normally. But little detail, it's not like a game changer thing to know. But while we're still executing this block, it's important to remember that the runtime is the old one. So even if during block N plus 1's execution, the runtime changes, it's applied from next block onward. So the next slide is basically the same process, just chained. So you can see, if I take the previous slide where we upgrade the runtime from bytes 1, 2, 3 to 4, 5, 6, if a block N plus 2 eventually comes around, a new runtime is being used to execute block N plus 2. So to recap, the blockchain itself is a state machine. The runtime is state transition function, the thing that dictates how we transition from one state to the other. Or the other definition is that it's application logic, or what we have kind of learned now, and it's a bit new, and we'll go into details of it tomorrow morning, the runtime is basically what dictates how we execute blocks. Right? Like, you can already like guess, probably one of those runtime APIs, like the functions that the node wants to talk to, is execute block. So the node would get some block from the outer world and tell the runtime, hey, execute this thing for me. And we'll learn about that tomorrow. So this is like the full diagram of Substrate now that incorporates a few more things that we talked about. Again, like not everything here like is explained in detail, but hopefully it should be clear, for example, why some of the boxes are like dark pink or purple. Like there are node components, and then there is the runtime component. Things like consensus, networking, transaction pool, block builder, you know, the component that builds new blocks, or import queue is the name for the component in Substrate that is responsible for the opposite. When you're not authoring blocks, you're just receiving blocks and you're importing them. These are all node-side components. Of course, the database where the state is also kept is also node-side, and then it's only the runtime. We have also runtime API and host function, the name for the communication between the two. Okay, there's two interesting questions that arise from here. One was also pointed out before. Consensus is not part of runtime. Something it's a bit you would expect sometimes otherwise, right? And I want to explain this a little bit. And the main reason that the consensus is not part of the runtime is that the consensus is not the state transition function. The consensus is not about how you go from one block to the other. It's more about once you... Yeah, exactly. It's actually about, let's say we all have a state transition function, WASM, whatever. Like there's, it's more about exactly how we agree on that. Like if I came up with if I did the state transition, did you also do the same? So short answer is it's not part of your state transition function. And there's an interesting analogy that hopefully explains it. Like the consensus is what, for example, HTTP is to a website. It's the protocol that then enables the state transition function to exist. So it actually doesn't make sense for it to be part of the runtime. It's basically my short answer. The other question that we get quite often is like, why is database not part of the runtime? So first, let's explain what we mean by database and state and what is the difference. So the state is this key value pairings that is all the net important data that we care about, like the code or account balances or whatever. It's also associated with different block numbers. And what I mean by database is a component on the node side that is storing this data. So in the database itself can be key value, can be whatever. Implementation detail, we don't care about it. So with that out of the way, now we can answer the question of why is the state kept on the node side? And the main answer for that is that the WebAssembly blob itself is just a pure function. It doesn't have the capabilities to actually store. It's not even persistent. Like you spawn a WebAssembly executor, you give it a block, and then you could kill it. Like it's not even like a persistent software artifact. It should be a stateless, pure function. So the ability to store data is inherently incompatible with it. So yes, WASM runtimes cannot store data, but crucially, the runtime is the one that makes sense out of the data. So the node is the component storing these key value pairings, but the node doesn't really understand them. Like it's only the runtime that makes sense out of them. So I have this is like a good one to maybe explain that. If we have the same state, some state, what the node sees is just some bytes that is key values. It doesn't know really what a particular key means. It also doesn't know how to interpret a particular value. But when the runtime looks at the same data or queries it, it would actually know that, for example, this particular key means someone's balance. This other key is actually the code or whatever. There's one exception to this, which is already clarified in this figure as well, which is the code. The code is the only part of the state where the node also has to know. It's one of the only handful of exceptions. That makes sense? Because the node has to know from where it has to get the code, you know, which part of the state it should look at. Mike.
So basically you're saying that the block contains a state, that part of it, that part of it is the code, and the code is the thing that is stateless. Like...
So everything, correct, but that first sentence triggered me, because we get this as I would say common misunderstanding. State is not in any block. State is associated with a block. Let me find the figure where I can. Yes, so the state is associated with block N. Like the block N actually doesn't contain any state. Like when I send block N to you, it's just transactions. There's no state in it.
It's transactions, but the stuff inside the code is only a pure function, like you said.
Yes.
But outside of it, here is some data, the code. Because like when the next block comes, it says, here's another code, right? It's not a function. The stuff inside the code is a function.
Yeah.
Again, the block contains several things. One of them is code.
It's not just the code. It's actually, I think that might also be a misunderstanding, as in the block contains something like a transaction that is called set code. You know, like, again, this doesn't mean any state is in the block. It's just a transaction that happens to have as one of its parameter some code.
Okay. Yep.
Right? For example, this set code could have just a hash of the code. And then the code itself comes from, I don't know, somewhere else.
So when you said before that the node doesn't know about, like, that it doesn't care about state, you said? Or what was it again?
The node cannot interpret the state.
Cannot interpret the state, except, like, you...
Except the code.
Except the code.
Exactly. Okay. So the code is one of the... I think there's, like, 5-6 example exceptions to this. Like, some pieces of the state where the node also has to know them. The most relevant one is code.
Okay, that's, I guess, what I was trying to word differently.
And this is not a question, this is basically like a doubt. You mentioned that node plus state plus code, but then you said, like, it is actually the code is in the state, right? So you said node and state and code and plus plus plus, right? So, and then why was the code moved to the part that it's part of the state?
Why was the code?
Like you said, it's part of the state, so that
yes.
You said,
so maybe this will show. So the node has a database, and yes. This database is keeping the state of, let's say, for the sake of simplicity, all blocks from Genesis to now.
Yes.
So there's like a lot of state copies there. Each of those copies of the state has its associated code in it.
Yes.
Okay. Now, is there a question left, or did I answer?
Is it the code, the running code?
Sorry?
I thought the code was the running code in WASM runtime.
So this code that is in state and it's in database is what we will, whenever we want to, for example, whenever I want to, like, let's say, do something with the runtime of block N, I will use this code. I put it in a WebAssembly I will put it in a WebAssembly executor, so and then I would.
Just for clarity, the code you're referring to is smart contracts, or is something totally else?
No, like, it's similar to smart contracts, but it's not. There's no smart contract here. Yeah. Let's please come to me after
okay,
class.
Okay. Thanks.
Okay. So let's. Wrap up with this few final slides. Something that I repeat a lot, I think it helps, is the first sentence here. Database, from the client's point of view, oh, I missed this one. It should have been node's point of view, is untyped key value. I don't know what are these types. I just know there's some bytes and they're ordered as key value. Okay, that's it. Let's do a quick recap of what we learned. Then we can have a final Q&A and then move on. So I first talked about, like, some principles of Substrate, why it's designed the way it is, and it's designed with a few choices in mind. Maybe I can maybe rephrase them as these are the important design choices of Substrate, that we use Rust to be safe when we program things, that it has a very generic design so we can easily swap components, and it emphasizes on governance and upgradability through this WebAssembly meta protocol. It's a decision that is made for you. You know, it's core part of the framework. We looked at some of the both positive and negative consequences of having this WebAssembly meta protocol. It wasn't all great. There's also some downsides. Like any other, like anything else, there's trade-off, of course. We should be realistic about it. We learned how Substrate is used to create blockchains outside of Polkadot, solo chains or sovereign chains, as we call them, or Polkadot parachains, or we also learned that Substrate is used to build the Polkadot relay chain itself. We looked at the state of smart contracts and light clients in Substrate. They were both kind of good news. I just gave you some pointers on, like, you know, these tools exist, these are the things you can do, or about some of them you will learn later in this course. And finally, we had this example of, like, looking at state transition function and how it works in detail to learn the meta protocol better. So I'll pause in this slide, which is just like a recap, and let's take more questions.
Yeah, when we upgrade the runtime, that seems like that itself goes through the consensus, so that is also, that goes in the state transition function, and every node must agree that yes, we have to upgrade it. upgrade the runtime itself.
Yeah, but that agreement is the same as every node has to agree. Yeah. I have to transfer 10 units from A to B.
So just want to say that, is it like we say every node that whenever runtime upgrade is coming, we have to prioritize it, or there is a chance that...
There's nothing special about... So you talk about that set code, right?
Yeah.
Right. That set code is, in principle, no different from transfer.
Okay.
Right?
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, your runtime can have some extra logic that says, if you see set code, do it first, or I don't know, like do this and this and that. There's also a question of who can call set code, right?
Mm-hmm.
Can anyone call it? Probably not. A runtime should probably gate that as like only execute set code if majority token holders say yes. Whatever. But point is, in principle, that set code is same as a transfer. It's just a transaction.
Yeah, that also goes through the mempool and all the lifecycle of the transaction.
All of that. Or you can even have a runtime that not through a transaction. For example, runtimes can be, unlike contracts, can have these hooks that are called. You can have some code that is executed on every block. So no, even if no transaction comes in, the runtime does something. A runtime can be programmed to, I don't know, generate some new code on its own and upgrade itself even without any transaction. Like, it's all up to the whatever the runtime is permitting. But if the runtime happens to permit a set code transaction, then it will be treated like any other transaction.
Cool. Thank you. Right. The next is in the state n plus one state.
Mm-hmm.
When we are making the state, we take the code of n block. Previous block.
Yes, yes.
And in the next block, we put that as the code. So when new code is being set, do we also rearrange the database?
Do we watch the database?
To make it compatible with the new code. So like we were learning in the smart contract upgradability,
uh-huh.
that if we can upgrade in a breaking way where actually the new smart contract code is reading the stored data differently.
So this is,
so
I see.
From that point of
view. You'll learn about this next week extensively.
Okay.
But this is, again, like nothing about substrates, especially meta protocol that I said, cares about this, right? If the runtime, for example, is storing account balances as U64, and in one runtime to the next runtime, it decides to upgrade them to U128, it should also deal with it, like do some migration that upgrades them or whatever. But the meta protocol is the same. And what is the meta protocol? The meta protocol is that, hey, there's a node. It will read the code from the state. It will execute it in a WebAssembly as WebAssembly. And whatever that WebAssembly does is the canonical state transition function. Nothing about this process changes. But yeah, this like going from U64 to U128, of course, you need to do something about it.
As a programmer, do we need to do, like in the smart contract, it was told that we need to run write
yes.
the migration code.
In this case as well, you need to do it.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. One piece. Okay.
I'm just curious in terms of engineering research. I think for the most part, like we see that blockchain is a skill for. I think there's like probably three or five things. One of them is consensus doesn't scale. But I've also read research on the database side where people are trying to optimize essentially writes into the database. I was wondering if you have any info in terms of what's the difference between the database that, you know, Parity or Web3 Foundation is building or researching on versus, you know, what's on Ethereum or other ones.
Yeah, I can give you two pointers. Again, not an expert on NFTs fields, but I know just some. I don't know, from through talking to people, I have some hints. Two things. One is that on Friday you learn about how Merkle trees are used as part of this database component, and something interesting that we're looking at is we use base 16 trees. For example, what if you change the base of that? But it's just a pointer for you. Maybe you can ask it again on Friday. Another one is that you can look at ParityDB and how it differs from RocksDB, which is the other default database that was used for many years in Parity Ethereum and in Polkadot. I think Sean will talk more about this next week, but it is actually optimized for not necessarily writes, more for account-based data structures. Like when you have a lot of account IDs, and most account IDs are, like most things are mapped by account IDs. And because account IDs are usually smaller than certain size, you can do some optimizations. But you need to look further into the, I don't know, the repo and the README and stuff yourself.
Okay.
Got it. Thank you very much.
All right.
Can we go back to the other slide?
The diagram?
Yes. Which of these elements are provided by Polkadot layer zero, and which of these elements you have to build if you want to build a parachain or app chain, or how does this works?
Okay, a bit out of scope, but I will answer it. Okay, I think it's good to answer it. So actually, no, this diagram, this is a good one to look at afterwards. This is in the appendix section. But I realize it's too much. I will just answer it here. If you are building a parachain, you do the same thing as you would do when you're building a solo chain, which is only provide your runtime. The rest is handled for you by the rest of the toolkit, like Substrate and Cumulus.
Just the runtime? Okay, well, so what's the difference between the runtime on Tansy and the runtime on a parachain?
It's the same.
It's the same.
Yeah.
Okay, thanks.
And building a runtime for a parachain, what I tried to say, building a runtime for a parachain, it's almost equal to building a runtime for a solo chain. Like Cumulus and Substrate provide this nice macros and abstractions where if you want a runtime to be parachain enabled, it's not like you have to code it fundamentally different. You just add, like, stick a flag somewhere that says, you know, this is parachain. And then it's a parachain.
Yes. Question?
Yes.
Yeah. You say that maybe you have bad metrics using WASM, and since it's some code that is cross-compiled to WebAssembly, it's not possible if maybe someone is interested in have only a parachain in his own node to cross-compile only a monolithic binary using the Substrate and generate a only one binary without the WebAssembly features?
One binary with WebAssembly?
No, without.
Oh, without, yes. Yeah. So you can't, I mean, if I've understood correctly, you're saying, what if we remove the WebAssembly part and just, so yeah, you can, I mean, it's a different product with different properties.
But cool works.
Yeah, of course.
And since I saw that there was some pallets related to networking like TCP and HTTP, I guess, previously in one of the first slides.
A nice slides.
Yeah.
Palette about HTTP.
It says palette, networking, TCP. It's because it's handling, possible to handle.
This is either, this is a mistake. Like I don't, there's no such thing. It's probably a typo or like, yeah.
I thought that maybe it was possible.
If you show me later which slide it is, I can correct it, or maybe it doesn't exist. There's no palette about networking, or none that I know of, or and none in these slides that I meant to convey. So I will.